I'm Michael Correa, and this is Psych Exam Review. In the previous video, I talked about how experts are able to think differently. And one of the main ideas is that they're able to think differently because they've spent a long period of time building the chunks of knowledge that they need for their field. And then they've automated a lot of those chunks so that they can draw upon them very easily. And this gives them what Anders Ericsson called a mental representation. And it's a mental representation for their field that's complex and refined. No matter what your situation is, what it is that you're trying to learn, what we can say is that the end goal is the same. What you want to do is build a large quantity of chunks of information in that field, and then you want to spend as much time as you can automating those chunks so that you can use them and think efficiently. As I've pointed out before, you won't be able to think like a doctor overnight. It's just not possible. So it's not the right goal. You need to recognize that thinking efficiently about complex topics is going to take a long period of time. It's going to take a lot of effort, a lot of study, no matter how well you study. So if your brain has been able to automate a task like reading, then there's no doubt that it can automate other kinds of chunks, but you need to recognize this will probably take a long time. And this is a case where IQ is less important than the time that you spend practicing. And we can see this in chess. If we look at some research by Merim Bilalic, Peter McCloud, and Fernand Gobet, they looked at young chess players and they found that while IQ did matter somewhat for their chess rating, it was not nearly as important as the amount of time that the children had spent practicing. And when they looked at the 23 elite players in their sample, they found that IQ was actually negatively correlated with their chess rating. And the reason for this was that the children with the highest IQs tended to spend less time practicing. And so other children with lower IQs were able to reach higher chess ratings because they put in more time. And so we want to remember that whatever it is that we're trying to learn, when it comes to building those chunks, we just have to put in the time. We need to spend a great deal of time practicing and practicing those basic chunks in order to build that mental representation. So if our goal is to build a complex and refined mental representation, what we need to figure out is what's in an expert's mental representation that's not yet in mine. So when chess players study the game, they look to what grandmasters do in different situations. So they look through a game and they see, okay, what would I do here? What did the grandmaster do? And that helps them to identify the gaps. And that suggests that the grandmaster is seeing something that they're not seeing. And then they can use this to help work on what is it that's being seen that I don't yet understand? Why is it I was going to make this move and the grandmaster did something different? If they can understand that, then they can gradually make progress in their play. So we want to do the same thing, whatever it is that we're studying. We want to say, what is it that an expert is noticing or thinking about that I'm not noticing or that I don't have the ability to think about yet? And this is a case where a teacher is really important. If you have a good teacher, what they should be doing is helping you to identify those chunks that you're missing. You say, here's the thing that you need to learn how to do in order to get to the next level. And they can also help you practice automating the chunks. They might say, okay, you're able to do this, but you need to do it so much that it becomes automatic so that you can do it every time. And then over time, as your skills progress, they find more and more nuanced and refined chunks that you need to work on. This brings us to where I think many modern teachers and approaches to education can lead students astray. It's something that actually goes back many decades in education, and it's a part of nearly all teacher training programs. And yet, I think it's frequently misinterpreted or misrepresented. And this is Bloom's taxonomy. Bloom's taxonomy is a model for how cognitive abilities develop. And it presents a hierarchy of educational objectives as one makes progress. So here's the original version of Benjamin Bloom's taxonomy. And we can see that the original model begins with objectives for knowledge, then comprehension, application, analysis, synthesis, and finally evaluation. I won't go into detail on each of these different steps here, but in his description of the taxonomy, Bloom does provide further breakdowns within each of these. And he also provides example questions or types of problems that students could work on that would help them develop these for different subjects, like math or English, history, etc. While Bloom's taxonomy is universally mentioned in teacher education programs, in my experience, there's frequently a fundamental misinterpretation of it. And I think this comes from the hierarchical nature of the model. And teachers and students often assume that they should be focusing on the higher level skills, the things that are higher up in the hierarchy. Those are more important because they're higher up. And so there's this common view that teachers should be trying to teach skills in evaluation and analysis rather than knowledge or comprehension. And I think this leads teachers to neglect or even actively denigrate those lower levels of basic factual knowledge, conceptual understanding, in favor of thinking that they're going to teach the higher order skills. In my opinion, this is a fundamental misunderstanding, and it's one that causes a lot of frustration for students. Because if teachers are too focused on higher order skills, and students are having a hard time with them, they might think that they just need to work on these higher order skills more. But I don't think that's usually the case. I think if you're struggling, you need to have humility. You need to look lower. You might say, what's the lowest educational objective that I might be having some difficulties with? So if you're having trouble with analysis or evaluation, it might not be because you need to work on evaluation. It might be because some of your conceptual understanding is actually weak. Or it may even be that there's basic factual information that you're just missing. You're not even aware of it. And it might be the case that if you had that factual knowledge or if your conceptual understanding was a bit clearer, that actually the analysis or evaluation would be much easier. It would make sense to you. So the reason those educational objectives are lower is that they're more important, not less important. And in the original description of the taxonomy, Bloom makes this case because he says when he describes the knowledge section that this is the knowledge that students must have in order to be acquainted with the field or to solve any problems in it. So it's absolutely fundamental. And later, he says that it's a hierarchy for a reason. It's a hierarchy because the higher levels demand that one has already mastered the ones beneath them. So it's not the case that you can skip over knowledge or conceptual understanding and only focus on higher order skills. That actually doesn't work very well. Remembering that the lower levels are necessary prerequisites for the higher order skills is why I prefer to think of this taxonomy in a three-dimensional way, as a pyramid. Now, Bloom did not provide a graphic representation of the model, so we can't say for sure that he would agree this is the best visualization, but I think it makes a lot of sense, because if we look at it as a pyramid, what becomes more obvious is the difference between the lower and higher levels. And this difference is represented in terms of the volume of the pyramid. So if we look at the volume of the base sections of the pyramid, so if we look at this shape, if we were to cut the pyramid off and then look at the lower part of it, that would be a shape called a frustum, we would see that that is many, many, many times larger than the capstone at the top. Then we could think, maybe that represents the time and the effort that we need to put into building those skills. And that means we're going to have to spend a tremendous amount of time building that base. Just like a real pyramid. We have to haul thousands and thousands of stones to build the base of the pyramid. Even though the capstone at the top, you know, glitters in the sun and, you know, maybe draws our attention, it's the base of the pyramid that we need to spend the most time on. And the same will be true for building our mental representation. We need to put in many, many hours hauling those stones of basic facts, terminology, you know, key concepts in the field. That's going to take up the majority of our time. But once we do that, we'll find it's much easier to ascend. And those higher order skills will start to emerge naturally. Once you have a broad base of knowledge, you'll start seeing connections and having new ideas and realizing how you could critique something because, oh, hey, I know this other thing that contradicts it. Suddenly, the higher order skills start to appear almost of their own accord. And so this is what I think we should emphasize to students. We need to point out that anytime you're spending effort and you're putting time into building conceptual understanding and basic factual knowledge, you're actually building the most fundamental blocks that are necessary for higher level skills. So if you're struggling with a higher order skill, you don't want to just keep bashing yourself over the head with that higher order skill. So if you're struggling with analysis, you don't want to say, well, I just need to practice analysis. And then you struggle and you fail. And then you say, I need to practice analysis. I struggle, fail. I need to practice analysis. Now, higher order skills do need some practice, but if you're making the same mistakes over and over, or you're repeatedly struggling with something, that's a sign it's probably something underneath. Maybe you need to review some concepts, or maybe there's some basic facts you don't know. That's what you should focus on. As E.D. Hirsch put it, achievement gaps are knowledge gaps. And what he meant was, the differences in student achievement are often due to differences in student knowledge. The students who know more are able to achieve more. And this is certainly the case in my own experience. I see that the best students are those who spend the most time and effort working on basic facts, basic terminology, getting the key concepts clear. Once they do that, you'll find the higher order skills are much, much easier. Or, as Herbert Harold Reed put it, the best geologist is he who has seen the most rocks. So when you're studying, when you're working on those basic building blocks, keep in mind, those are the fundamental things. What you're spending your time and effort and energy on are actually the most important things to do in order to build expertise. And any teacher or anyone else who tells you that factual knowledge isn't important, or you can just Google things or look things up, you don't need to memorize the terms, you don't need to have the basic concepts totally mastered, anyone who tells you those sorts of things is simply wrong, and they don't really understand how learning works. So I hope you found this helpful. If so, please like the video and subscribe to the channel for more. Thanks for watching.